Hello, hello, my HRISP. I am your host, Chavonne Mateen, and welcome to the fourth, that's right, we're four episodes in already, of the HRIS Streamline Podcast, the one and only podcast out here empowering HRIS professionals like you. Now, today's episode is being sponsored and brought to you by Value Personnel, where we source and recruit HRIS professionals and match them with exceptional companies across the country. Now, for more information, please visit us at www.valuepersonnel.com today. We'll be speaking with Mr. Roy Altman. Now, Roy has a very robust background in human resource technology. He's currently the CEO and founder of Peopleserv, faculty for the new Master's in Human Capital Analytics and Technology program at the New York School of Professional Studies. He's an editorial committee member for the International Association for Human Resources Information Management Workforce Solutions Review, and he is also an author, he's a thought leader, and yes, he's delivering strategies with a proven track record. Roy, let's go ahead and jump right into this interview as I'm eager for the HRIS community to hear from you. Can you just let us know what a typical day for you looks like?
Oh, I don't know if there's such a thing as a typical day. I would say normally on a normal project, I would manage HRIS strategy and operations or manage HR analytics strategy and or operations. And the strategy part and the operations part are very different. So, yeah, I do a lot of different things and keeps the days going by quickly.
All right. I can certainly imagine that you're very busy. All right. So how did you realize that this was it for you and this is what I'm going to focus on?
Yeah, well, I've had kind of an unconventional career path. I started out as a musician and composer. Shortly after college, I realized that I needed a backup. So I learned how to become a programmer. And interestingly, I found that the process that one goes through in composing a piece of music and designing a software system is fairly similar. The main difference is that with the software, you're trying to solve a business problem, and with the music, you're trying to realize the music that you hear in your head. But that kind of worked for me for a while, so I had that dual career path going. And, finally, I just went into technology full-time. And then about 20 years ago, I worked on a project in HR. And what I realized that when you're coding, when you're designing systems, there is an answer, and you find that answer, and you feel real good that you found that answer. But in HR, you're dealing with people, and there's never an answer. Mm-hmm. There's never a pure answer. That's what makes it frustrating, but it also makes it interesting.
So were there any other personal decisions that weighed heavily in your decision to just say, you know what, I'm going to go around this another way, and I'll still do my music on the side?
Well, I loved what I did. You know, I love music. You know, I love technology, and now I love HR. So it's not like I'm settling for a career that's not as fulfilling. It's just as fulfilling. Mm-hmm. It's just kind of a different focus.
Okay. So what's the most exciting part about what you do every day?
I love designing solutions. I hate the expression, but I love the concept of thinking out of the box, taking a different kind of look at problems and coming up with unique solutions that really drive it forward and kind of change the way we look at work and the way we approach work.
I know you went into programming first before you said, okay, you know what, this is it now. There's no turning back. But I wish I would have known that before I decided this.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people have had more conventional career paths, mm-hmm. Gotten a job in industry and stayed there and worked their way up through management. And, that's kind of a tempting thought, but I don't think that would have been right for me. I mean, mm-hmm. I ended up being an entrepreneur. I'd say if I could change anything, I would have gone into entrepreneurial activities earlier in my career. I wouldn't have gone with the mindset of a conventional career. I probably should have embraced the non-conventionalness of, if that's a word, of my mm-hmm. career earlier on. And that would have kind of served me better for where I ended up.
Gotcha. And I so agree with you on that. I said, there's one thing to get that specialization, but to definitely have some entrepreneurial classes up under your belt, that would have definitely helped me along the way as well, so I can certainly relate to you on that. Okay. So What type of advice would you give someone considering a career in HRIS or who is currently working in the field?
Well, it's a very exciting time to be in the field. You know, HR is larger than it used to be. It used to be about compliance and you know, dealing with the workforce. But now, you know, we're at that point in time where our concept of work and the workforce is changing, mostly due to AI and other social changes that are going on. So, you know, traditionally, it served people's needs to be very cautious about making technology decisions. Wait to see what's established. You know, be go with the majority. Don't be an early adopter. That doesn't hold anymore because technology is changing so rapidly. So I would say try to anticipate trends and try to be on the forefront of trends. You could still kind of hedge your bets. You don't have to kind of go all in and bet the farm on the latest technology, but you definitely have to be aware of the trends going on and, you know, and embrace them and not be afraid of forward-thinking technology.
Absolutely. And I know last time we spoke, we were talking about, you know, analytics. So are you able to just touch on the importance of analytics and how those metrics and things of that nature, how they're driving business results and those skill sets are extremely important for businesses? Can you just touch on that piece?
Sure. I mean, there's been a long-time trend in the industry. When I started out and still, the focuses were on processing transactions. You know, computers were good at processing transactions. They did things very quickly, and the transactions were hard. It used to be on paper. Now it's automated through workflow, and that was great because it took HR people out of the realm of being transaction processors and let them be partners to the businesses, which was what they were supposed to do. So it kind of empowered HR. And now we're moving into kind of beyond the transactions to decision support. And decision support is really about analytics. And that, in a sense, is empowering every manager in the company to make smarter decisions about the workforce. It's not about processing the transactions. It's about really understanding the workforce and really understanding how to make decisions that are most effective. It's been shown repeatedly, there's very high correlation between companies that make quantitative analysis and really make analytics part of every decision and the success of that company. And that trend's going to continue. So it's really important that you become like a quantitative organization. And furthermore, kind of the techniques that are involved in predictive analytics, you know, particularly they kind of center around pattern recognition, which is kind of the opposite of transaction processing. Transaction processing is doing one thing at a time really fast. Pattern recognition is recognizing trends in the workforce. And I was talking about humans being so unpredictable. And we're trying to quantify human behavior, and that's really hard to do. And that's kind of a straight line into machine learning and artificial intelligence. So really analytics can both serve your needs, can be good for the bottom line, can make you more effective managers, and also kind of can set you up for the next generation of technology, which is going to really take us somewhere special, I think.
Oh, yes, absolutely. That was awesome. Thank you so much for touching on that. So, Roy, what is a book or a few books that you recommend to our HRIS community and the listeners out there? Like, what's a must-read for them, in your opinion?
Yeah, one that I read recently, which is kind of a focus of a lot of my writing lately, a book called Reinventing Organizations by Frederick Laloux. And I really think with the way business is going and with the trends toward the gig economy and artificial intelligence, we have to rethink the way we look at the organization. Organizations, currently the organizational hierarchy, was designed during the industrial age. You know, they manufacture things at scale, and that's why we built these multi-level organizational hierarchies. That's all changing. The whole nature of business is changing. And the way we should manage now is small teams and networks of teams that can collaborate one another and coach one another and help one another. It's really more like self-managing. We're tending towards self-managing structures, and that's what that book is all about. It gives a lot of case studies on self-managing organizations, and it shows how successful they are and how motivated the employees are. So that was one that really hit home with me.
And that author again, Roy, can you just mention his name one more time for the listeners?
Frederick Laloux. He's a Belgian author.
Okay.
And the book is called Reinventing Organizations.
Reinventing Organizations. That is awesome. Now, do you have any other recommendations? And also, please feel free to mention your work as well.
Okay. Thank you for that. I read Laszlo Bock's Work Rules was a good book. Kind of a must read was Tim Berners-Lee's books, Weaving the Web. It was a book by called Team of Teams by General Stanley McChrystal. He was the commander in Iraq. He determined that to defeat the enemy, we had to reorganize into small teams and networks of teams, kind of on the same topic, but really applied to the military. So, you know, when I heard that the military doesn't really manage itself through the hierarchy, I thought, maybe I'm onto something.
Okay.
I have a new article coming out in IRIM's Workforce Solutions Review, the November issue. The article is called Using Analytics to Promote Organizational Agility, and I propose a new statistic called the Agility Quotient, which is a way of quantifying how agile you are as an organization and to be used as a way to promote more agile behaviors in the organization. So hopefully I'll be doing a lot more writing and speaking on that.
Okay, awesome. Well, you guys got that information first. So definitely check out the article once it has been published. Roy, it has been a great pleasure to have you join us here on the HRIS Streamline podcast. And as you know, this is the one and only podcast that focuses on empowering HRIS professionals. Roy, how can our listeners find out more about you? Do you have a website or a social media handle you'd like to share with us today?
Sure. You can go to peopleserv.com, P-E-O-P-L-E-S-E-R-V, no E at the end. You can connect with me on LinkedIn. I'm pretty easy to find, Roy Altman. Or you can just email me at roy@peopleserv.com. Once again, that's peopleserv without an E at the end.
That is absolutely awesome, Roy. Well, there it is, my HRIS peeps. Thank you so much for joining us for the fourth episode of the HRIS Streamline Podcast. You can find us on SoundCloud, Google Play, iTunes, YouTube, Twitter. Am I hitting them all? Maybe not, but wherever there's a social media presence, you'll be very well likely to find us at the HRIS Streamline Podcast. Now, don't forget, if you'd like to be a guest on the show or if you have a guest suggestion, give us some feedback there. Please email us at HRISStreamline@valuedpersonnel.com. Again, Roy, it has been a great pleasure to have you on.
And until next time, we're going to get the HRIS out of here.